So there's a particular smell that I smelled this one day that I think everybody knows what it's like, but you don't really know what it is. The air was wet, and I think it's just weird. Like, weird. I was in this particular room in this small town in South Carolina. It was like a lot of rooms many of you have been in. It's an old prefab building. As we make our way into that room, you can just smell the yeah. It's a mix between like an eighth grade gym sock, old books, and mold. We get into this room, and this room, if you can picture it with me, it's got an old chalk board, metal desk for the teacher, and desks everywhere. Mold. The air conditioner rattles in the background as it's shaking the window just to make sure that the humidity is pushed out the doors so that we can survive. This room is filled with desks, but the interesting piece of this is that there was only like a dozen of us in this room. And as we sit there, we see her. She was a very odd character, if I'm being honest with you. And she had these sharp eyes with blue eyeshadow. It's the 90s. Huge glasses. Very pointy nose. Tiny little lips, thinner than yarn. She was a firecracker. And to be honest with you, she was really hard to get along with, and hard to love, and hard to like. And every single time you would move in these old buildings, you know that it creeps. You hear the floors, and it's so hollow that, like, literally people in Antarctica can hear you. I mean, it's just loud. We can hear her coming. She stands before the class with her stubby little fingers, beady little eyes, and pointy nose. Puts her glasses up and says, "Welcome to speech. I'm Mrs. Ellis." That was the first day of the worst year of my entire life. It was absolutely. I'm fully convinced to this very day that every single day Ellis woke up on the wrong side of the bed. It was tough. It was tough. And for some reason, there was something about her personality that just rubbed everybody the wrong way. I'm convinced she might have rubbed Jesus the wrong way, to be honest with you. Maybe you've had bosses like that or teachers like that before, and that's what this scenario was. And so I'm sitting in this speech class as a junior in high school, and what starts to happen is I think there were just targets. Oh, so now it's his turn. Now it's her turn. Now it's his turn. His turn. Really, I have one girl in my class, guys. I'm dead serious. Graduated with 8 people. Come on. She was the only one, so she was the best one. Everybody else was horrible. And it just so happens that this day was not my turn. I don't know what happened that particular day, but I walk into class like everybody else does, and I'm just going to be honest with you. Like, I'm not like the you could probably tell I could talk quite often. And I was a passionate young kid. I was a little loud, a little obnoxious, but hey, you know what? That's just what it is. And so, but I wasn't like different than any other kid in my class, and we were all like this. And so we were a lot to take in. And so we walk into class, and just like all the other times, as soon as the bell rings, it's loud, it's all this. And then, I don't know what happened this day, but this day was different than all other days. Because as soon as the bell rang, some tempers started to flare. And authority started, leadership started to be flexed, hardcore in this particular moment. And I don't know what it was, but Ellis looks at me, something I did, something I said, and she just pops off and yells at me. Well, I had enough. And I was ready to incite change. And so I was going to be the change agent. And so then I look at her and I said, "No, ma'am." And I start ripping right back at her. And I'm standing, she's standing at her desk, I'm standing at my desk. And then I don't know all the details of what was said, but I'm telling you what, she raised her voice, I raised my voice, and I said, "I'm done." And I blow out of that door, middle of the day, by the way, blow out of that door and leave. And I said, "I'm over it, I'm out of here." So I go, room, I'm thinking, what just happened? This was insane. Like, why did they went from 0 to 100 in 0.3 seconds? What just happened? Who does she think she is talking to people like that? That's so rude. And then I never once thought about me, but I was thinking about how moving along she was. So I have a 20-minute drive from my school to my house, pull into the neighborhood, get into the house, pull up, open the garage, walk in, and right as you walk in the garage door, there was a wall, and her kitchen was right there. And I know many of you don't know what this is, but there was a telephone hanging on the wall, and it was going berserk. Ring, 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 ring. It was one of those, y'all remember those telephones with the really big numbers? That's what we had. Not that we were blind, but that it was just kind of the thing, you know? I mean, it was just one of those things. And so I go and I pick up the phone, and I say, hello. And it was this old, crackly voice from a man named Raiden, who was about that tall, and he was our principal. And he says, Aaron. I was like, oh, here it is. This is Mr. Raiden. I heard about what happened today. They're coming to school tomorrow. And tomorrow, in the afternoon after school's over, we're going to have a meeting with all of your teachers and your coaches. And we need your parents to come. You're suspended. I've never been suspended for anything. Yes, I went to detention because I was tardy and I was a talker, okay? Like, that's what it was. But I never, literally never really did anything wrong before. And then this was the moment, first of all, even my dad is listening to this right now. I don't even know if he knows that I was suspended as my junior year of high school. Sorry, Mom. But anyway, I get to the meeting. I'm sitting in the meeting. And here's the point. Whether I liked it or not, Ellis was the teacher, and I was the student. And it was my job to let her do her job. Whether I agreed with her tactics or not was irrelevant. My job was to be the student. Her job was to be her teacher. I started thinking about that. And I thought, that's probably whether you popped off at your boss or your mom or your dad, but at the bare bottom level, bottom of the barrel, of the feeling is this. Sometimes it's hard to trust someone who's in authority over us. Wouldn't you agree? Sometimes it's just hard to believe the best that, oh, they have my best interests at heart, or, oh, this is, they're righteous in their feelings towards this, or they're just in their feelings towards that. Like, sometimes it's just hard for us to trust people that are in authority over us. I was reading this great article this week by Kevin Williamson. He wrote it in late December or mid-December of 2020, and he's really making an assessment of culture. And he's not a believer, but he wrote this article called Tribal Power, Tribal Authority, something along those lines. And this is what he said in this particular article that I think is fascinating. He says, we worship power when we hold it. And we're cool if I'm the one in authority, if I'm the one that has leadership, we're good. I trust myself. I trust that my motives are pure, my motives are right, my motives are holy and good. He says, or when it is held by a member of our tribe. So somebody who's like us, thinks like us, talks like us, is a part of us. This could be somebody in a political party. This could be somebody in a particular theological persuasion. This could be somebody in our neighborhood. Like, this could be anything. If we know who they are, then we are more apt to trusting them. If we love them, we're more apt to trusting them. But, he goes on to say, and we are fearful when power, when it is wielded or held by someone who seems to be alien or hostile to us. So the idea is this, is that we're fearful when we don't know you. We're fearful when you're not like me. We're fearful when you are opposite of me. But when you're like me, then I can actually believe that you're going to be righteous in your power. The truth of the matter is, it's absolutely hard to be under authority. It's hard. But I just want to propose this to you today. Did you know that you were made to be under authority? It might not be popular to say it like this, but can I just say it as clearly as I can? Would you give me permission to do that? You're made to be ruled. You're made to be ruled. You're made to live in submission to a king. And the king is not you. And the king is not your spouse. The king is not your child. The king is not your job. The king is not a political leader. The king is Jesus. And you were crafted with that in mind to be ruled and reigned over by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and the author of life. And we are to be under his authority. Now, I get it. It's not easy to hear it. It's not easy to live it. But that's how we're made. And I know it feels so current. Does it not? Like, this is the fallout of what we've seen in our culture for a long time. Now, I know a lot of us are like, man, it's just all over my news feed. It's all over the news that we read. It just seems like the front pot is boiling over and it's in the flames and it's flaring up and all this stuff. It's like, yeah, I would agree it is. But this idea of not trusting authority is not new to our generation. Go ask somebody who's lived for a while and they would say, no, it happens all the time. If you don't believe that we've kicked back and authority is not new, why don't you just go ask a parent today? You got a little ankle biter in your house that kicks back on your authority every day. Do they not? They're constantly pushing on you and on me with regard to who's in charge. Now, some of you don't have kids, so go ask somebody who does. And then if you one day you'll have a child, maybe God will give you you will learn that they're doing the same thing that you did when you were a kid. Because did we all not get back on authority as a kid? Oh, so this is the church that never did that. Cool, bunch of liars. You might need this message more than you think you do. Because I do too. Because we're all prone to trusting our own power. But the reality is the power you have is nothing compared to the almighty power that God wills and owns. So we are to submit to him. And this is not a new issue in our generation or even in a practical sense in any generation that is represented in this room today. It has its roots all the way really back in Mark 11. In Mark chapter 11, we wrap up this particular chapter and head full steam ahead into Mark chapter 12 of today as well. And we see these religious leaders that are under the impression that they have a ton of authority. And they come at Jesus with this question that I think all of us have asked one time or another with someone who's in authority, or it's been asked of us if we are in authority. Who do you think you are? Who do you think you are? Where do you think you get that power? Where do you think you get that jurisdiction to talk to me that way and lead like that? Like, who do you think you are? And those religious leaders of this day are going to ask Jesus that very same question. And Jesus is going to be like, sweet, thanks for the question. I'll show you. So here we pick up in this story, in Mark chapter 11, verse 27, we see this question, who do you think you are? And we're going to answer that today. And they came again to Jerusalem, and as he was walking in the temple, remember, this was Monday, now this is Tuesday, and so the chief priests and the scribes and the elders came to him, and they said to him, by what authority? Everybody say, authority. Authority. By what authority are you doing these things? Or who? You got a what? And a who? Gave you this authority to do them. So if you think about this for a second, what had happened between our study last week and this week was Monday night. No, I'm not talking about football. What happened Monday night were these religious leaders, they're like, what just happened in this temple this day where Jesus walks in the door and totally starts throwing tables and kicking people out because they were creating a mockery of God's house. And Jesus says, no. We're not doing this. So Monday night happens, and a council happens. A meeting in the darkness, which, by the way, is where a lot of drama happens. In church life, secret meetings in the dark that not everybody else knows about. When you're having meetings like that, you're already in the wrong, just so you know. Already in the wrong. So that's where they're at. So they have this council of the Sanhedrin, the religious leaders of the day. Probably about 75 people in a particular room. If you could picture it with me, there are rows in a U shape. several rows in a U-shape comprising about 70 or so chairs. And then there's a pulpit in the middle, and they come and they plead their case to the Sanhedrin and to the leaders of that day. And so, as it happens, you hear somebody at the, you just get in the room with me for a second, the room is hot because there's a bunch of people in there, and you hear the pounding of the gavel, order, 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 y'all knock it off, we're going to be here all night long if you guys don't stop. And you hear somebody come, man, I can't believe what we saw today. Who's this Jesus think he is walking into our temple, calling us out for the way we decide to give temple sacrifices so that people could sacrifice these animals, receive the forgiveness of their sins? Like, does he not know what we were doing? Of course we should be doing this. And he comes in and tells us that we've created not a house of prayer, but a den of robbers. This guy's insane. I agree. We should do something about it. So they meet all night long and devise a plan. And the plan, let's get him to self-incriminate. Let's get him to prove that he is not who he says he is. Great. Do we have any suggestions? We do. Let's ask him some questions and get him talking. Because we all know as soon as we start talking, sometimes we can get ourselves into trouble, unless you're Jesus. And then you never get yourself into trouble once you start talking, because all you speak is truth. So let's back him into a corner. So that's exactly what they did. In the next several weeks, we're going to study this idea of questioning Jesus. And this first one deals with authority. So he says, by what power? So he says, by what authority do you do these things? And who gave you this authority? That word authority, it means power. It means, like, jurisdiction. So, who gave you the power and authority to flex that power and authority on these specific things? What is he talking about? Well, first he's talking about what they did in the temple on Monday. Like, why would you do that? Who told you you could come and do that? But more than that, there was authority that Jesus had already flexed throughout his ministry in the Gospel of Mark. I want to give you just a quick glance of three major ways Jesus kind of did his authority in Mark. The first thing is Jesus taught with authority. This is Mark chapter 1, verse 22. The scripture says, and they were astonished at his teaching, for he had taught them as one who had authority and not as one of the scribes. In other words, all those religious leaders, they're just pocket fuzz. It's marshmallows and cupcakes. Like, it's not real. It's all carbs, no meat. Tastes good going down, but you're hungry about 15 minutes later. That's called a China buffet, y'all. That's what it is. Like, you eat all that lo mein, and then you're like, dang, I'm so full, because I had a ton of MSG in it. And then you go home, and about 3 o'clock, you're like, dude, I could eat an entire pork tenderloin myself right now. Because you carb loaded, and it burns off quick. And he's like, that's what they're noticing. Whoa, that's a ton of lo mein and no meat. I don't know why I have a lot of food illustrations. It's my weakness, I guess, but anyway. So he says he's one with real authority. And he comes on and he says later in Mark chapter 1, and they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, what is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. They've never seen anything like this. And so Jesus comes onto the scene, and he actually has power in his teaching, authority in his words. Number two, another way that we see Jesus' authority is he healed and forgave with authority. Jesus was the only one who actually could forgive people of their sin. In this story, the paralytic that was studied in the Gospel of Mark, the religious leaders were tweaking out about, wait, hold on, what just happened? You just told this guy to stand up and rise, and he's like, hold on, there's way more to the story than this. And this is what we get in Mark chapter 2. Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier to say to the paralytic, a guy who's paralyzed, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? Which is harder? Both. Who's up for both? Both are hard. He goes, watch this. But that you may know, keyword, phrase, that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, take up your bed, and go home. Jesus has the power in, because his word is authoritative. Because when Jesus begins to speak, it is God speaking. When Jesus begins to speak, that was a great spot for an amen, by the way. When Jesus begins to speak, it is God speaking. Try that one more time. When Jesus begins to speak, it is God speaking. There we go. Awesome. You'll get it. It's fine. We're good. It's God speaking. And so, like, you don't have the authority. say be healed and it happens. I know you might think you do, but you don't. It's God who has the authority to do that. And you might be a vessel of prayer that God chooses to use. But you don't carry the authority in and of yourself. You don't carry the authority to forgive sin. But Jesus does. Jesus does. And that made them go bonkers. Bonkers. Because it exposed the reality that they were off. They were off. Number three. Is he commissioned with authority? This is awesome. Jesus was like, even Jesus knew, even though he could be the one-man show, like he could be the P.T. Barnum of the day, you know, like he could be the guy who's the one-man show, he could do it, he could bring it all together, but what he did was he said, it's going to be more effective if I commission them with authority too. So that the gospel will spread even further faster. So here's what he has, Mark chapter 3. He appointed the 12, meaning now he calls not just disciples, but apostles. Why did he do it? Remember the key phrase in Bible study? So that's the hinge that everything hangs on. He says he commissions and he appoints the 12. So why did he do that? So that, here we go, so that they might be with him, so there's relationship there, and that he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. Jesus gave him the authority that he had. He's the only one who could do it. Matter of fact, John's gospel says that God gave him the authority. The Great Commission in Matthew 28 says that God has given me this authority, and now I'm giving this to you so that you can now go advance the gospel and people can get saved. And that took all the power. That took all the authority. It decentralized the power, friends. The centralized power was the temple and the religious leaders of the day. There was a giant V to them. And when Jesus came in, he said, that's not how this thing works. I'm going to decentralize that authority onto, it's going to be God and God alone, and I'm going to make you little missionaries every single place that you go. You will now carry that power and authority because you're saved and the Holy Spirit lives inside of you to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Acts 1, chapter 1, verse 8. You're now bringing that authority with you as you live. Why is this important? The reason that this is important is because the author is the only one authorized to give authority. Did you catch that? The author is the only one authorized to give true authority. Author is in there every time. That's where the true power comes from Jesus Christ and him alone. And what just happened in this particular moment was it wasn't in a particular man, it wasn't in a particular system, it wasn't in going to the temple, it wasn't in doing all those other things. It exposed your idolatrous, not you, but these religious leaders, idolatrous religious heart, thirsting for power, welding structures that oppress people. And he's like, nope, I'm blowing it all. And it's about one man, not all these men. This created massive problems for these religious leaders of their day. And it exposed that their authority had more holes in it than Swiss cheese. And it exposed their idolatrous and sinful heart. And notice what Jesus does next. Pick up the next part of the verse. Jesus said to them, oh, I will ask you one question. Answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. Was the baptism of John from heaven or from man? Answer me. So Jesus does excellent, excellent argumentation. If you're ever in an argument, you just do what Jesus does. You just start asking them questions. People are coming at you and grilling you. You're like, hold on, what do you mean by that? Hold on, can you clarify for me? And just start grilling them as they're grilling you, and then it gets all the attention from you and it exposes maybe something that they've got going on in their ear first. So Jesus comes to them and starts asking these questions. And I think it's fascinating. He goes all the way back to John the Baptist. Now you have to ask yourself, why in the world would Jesus go all the way back to John the Baptist? Why does that even matter? I want to read this quote to you by Warren Wiersbe. He is a great Bible preacher. And he said, the reason that he does this is because God does not teach us new truth if we have rejected the truth that he's already revealed. John the Baptist's whole ministry was prepare the way of the Lord, prepare the way of the Lord. The Messiah is coming, the Messiah is coming. And experience this baptism of repentance. And he is preparing the way, revealing the Christ that is coming. And what Wiersbe is saying and what Jesus is getting at is, why would you begin? You want something new, but you're not believing what's already been told. And I think some of us live in that world right now. Like, I just need a fresh word from the Lord. Awesome. Open your Bible. Open your Bible. Josh and I went together, and we heard something several weeks ago, and it was like, I just want to hear God's voice. Out loud, audibly. Sweet, read your Bible out loud. And then you get to hear God's voice. I just need to hear it more. Like, sweet, do it more. Because you have everything you need in the contents of this book. This is the very revelation of God. It reveals God to human beings. And listen, some of us might want all these new things, but you're not believing that which has already been revealed to you in the Word. Start here and see what God does. So, John the Baptist. Now they're in a quandary. Because essentially what they're saying is Jesus is going, so which one is it? Is it heaven or is it man? Was he sent by God or was he doing this by himself? On his own thing. Puts them in a corner. What's he going to say? What are they going to do? So here's the text. They discussed it with one another. Time out, we're going to have a meeting. That's what you think. I don't know what you think. I don't know what you think. It's a little weird. If we say, look at the text, if we say he's from heaven, then he's going to say, well, why didn't you believe him? Duh. Oh, it's totally a God thing. Sweet. Why didn't you believe him all those years when he was doing that by the Jordan River? Like, why didn't you hear when he said, make way in the desert, like, prepare the way of the Lord? The Messiah is coming. Like when we heard him say, behold, there's the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Why did he not go, oh, duh. Like this whole time, like we've been waiting for 400 years for the Messiah. He's actually here in our lifetime. This is legit. Exactly. But, shall we say for man, check this out. They were afraid of the people, for they all held that John was really a prophet. So they get to this point where they're saying, okay, if we say he's from heaven, then they're going to push us into a corner. Jesus will say, well, you should have believed. To which everybody said, amen. Then on the other side, if we say he's not from heaven and he's from man and he's doing this thing on his own, this is pretty self-incriminating because why didn't we deal with him? We should have dealt with him. We should have called him out. We're the religious leaders of the day. We should have dealt with him that he was a rogue person, but he wasn't rogue. The people loved him and they loved his ministry, and it did prepare the way for Jesus to come. We're in a quandary. Which I want to just point out the tension of belief and fear. There is an undercurrent narrative within the Gospel of Mark that he is exposing the human heart. We are prone to faith and fear, and that tension we live in all the time. All the time. And notice here's where they're at. You see, where the religious leaders are at right now is like, I know we totally should have believed. We're kind of messing this thing up right now. You are messing this thing up right now. We should have believed. But we didn't. And we're afraid of them. Who's them? The people. You see, they're in a position now where they have to remain in the tension of pleasing the court of public opinion. They've got Rome to keep at bay so that Rome doesn't totally jack with old temple processes and all those things. And they've got the crowd of people who have their own sorts of needs. And so they've got this court of public opinion that God is not even in the mix. God's not even a part of the equation. They're fearful of people. And when you're fearful of people, you will not do what God has asked you to do. When you're fearful of people, you will not do what God has asked you to do. The book of Proverbs calls it the fear of man. Proverbs says that the fear of man lays a snare. It's a trap. It is a trap to get in because you're always going, looking over your shoulder of what is my wife going to think? What's my boss going to think? What are they going to think if I go all in with the Lord? What are they going to think if I just start living out my faith and I start becoming vocal about who Jesus is and I actually believe that Jesus is who he says he is. His word will come to completion. as a kingdom ambassador in this world, and I'm a person of faith, not a person of fear, then like what we do in that moment is like, no, I can't handle it. I can't handle it. Because I don't know what they're going to think. And the quickest way to forget, well, let me say this way. If you and I constantly live for the approval of men, we will never live for the approval of God. Or a better way might be saying this. The quickest way to forget about what God thinks about you is to remember what everybody else thinks about you. You don't live for the approval of man, you live for the approval of God, which is the Father. And if you have embraced Christ by faith, you are approved. You are approved. You're in. You're in. So, how do they answer this guy? Jesus, we don't know. We don't know what you're trying to say here. Like, this is weird. I'm too afraid of them. I'm actually now really afraid of you. We don't know what, we don't know. We don't know, which there again indicts their own authority. They really have none. Faux authority, faux leadership, it's fake. It's disingenuine. We don't know. And then Jesus said to them, oh, okay, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. Say that to Jesus. Just too bad, so sad. What's interesting, though, is he actually does tell them, but not directly. Jesus begins to tell a story then. Who do you think I am? I'll show you. Let me show you. And he tells this story in Mark chapter 12, verse 1. And he began to speak to them in parables that a man planted a vineyard and put a fence around it and dug a pit for the wine presses and built a tower. In the picture, he's digging a wine press, digging a hole in the ground. He built a fence around this beautiful vineyard, and he's really intentional with this particular vineyard. He says, and they leased it to tenant farmers, very common in their day, and went into another country. And when the season came, he sent a servant to the tenants to get from them some of the fruit of the vineyard. Next verse. And they took him and beat him, that servant. Took him and beat him and sent him away empty-handed. And again, he sent them another servant, and they struck him on the head and treated him shamefully. And then he sent another, and him they killed. And so with many others, some they beat, and some they killed. Now, this is an intense story. This is a super intense story, and I want to give you what Jesus is saying here. The man who plants the vineyard, the owner, is God. God is the owner. The vineyard is Israel, the nation of Israel. And the tenants are the leaders of that day, the religious leaders of that day, the people in leadership in Israel. And then he sends these servants along the way. He sends these servants to go and check in on the field, to go check in on the vineyard, to go check in on the leadership, to make sure they're doing what the farmer or what the owner wants them to do in the vineyard. And they send these particular servants, and notice how quickly the tenant farmers are like, you can't tell me what to do. Who do you think you are coming and telling me how to run the vineyard? The owner hired me. You're the servant. How can you tell me what to do? And so quickly, they did not like what these servants were doing. And so they just resorted to violence. And beat them and killed them. Who are the servants? They're the prophets, the judges, sent to woo God's people back to the Father. Now, I want to give you just a list. There's many, but I'm going to give you five today of these particular prophets that God sent that are like these servants in this story to the nation of Israel. Number one, Elijah. That's fine. Everybody say Elijah. Yes, sir. Elijah. And Elijah was a prophet. 1 Kings 18, you can read this on your own. And if you want this, we can maybe find a way to get it to you. Maybe we can post it on Facebook so that you can download it. But Elijah, and he was a prophet, and what he did is he confronted Ahab and Jezebel. And what he did was he confronted their sin, and he called them out, put them on Front Street. That's what a prophet does, is a prophet is a truth teller. Thus says the Lord. And he did this. And then, check out the result. He had to flee for his life. In order for him to maintain his life, these people made it so hard on him that because he was speaking the truth, he now had to run for the hills so that he could live. Prophet number two, Hananiah's persecutor was Asa. Check this out. Hananiah was criticized Asa for, look at this, trusting in Syria's help more than God's help. So what he was doing was saying, hey, you are creating a functional savior. That is Syria. Syria won't love you. Syria won't protect you. But the God of the Bible will. And you're placing your trust in a foreign power, which explicitly says in the Gospels, and in Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah even says, you should not trust in anyone other than the Father. And so he calls this leader out, and check this, for simply saying, don't trust in Syria. Straight up through the jail without thought. Zechariah confronted the people of Judah. Anybody know who Judah is? Yes, he is my son, but does anybody know who Judah is? The tribe of the nation of Israel, God's people of the Old Testament. So all Zechariah is doing is going to the people of God, and he's saying, you better treat this word as holy. You better believe every word of it. You better pattern your life after it. You better believe this. This is where truth lives. Truth doesn't live out here. Truth doesn't live in some other leader. Truth doesn't live in any other space but right here in the context that they didn't have this particular book, but in the law of God, the Old Testament. That's where the truth lives. And you better believe it. The people of God, Joash, executed him for it. Calling the people of God to believe the truth of God's word. They didn't like it so much. Just a little sidestep. That happens every day. And you might not ever physically kill and execute someone, but because somebody puts truth in front of you, this has happened to me, puts truth in front of you and you don't like the way that it's packaged, you just cancel. You cancel. Well, that's offensive to me the way that that's said. Is less interested in how that truth makes you feel. He's more interested in you obeying that truth. When you talk to your children like that, you're like, I know you, it's hard for you to hear, but Dad doesn't care if it's hard for you to hear. It's good for you to hear this. Do you know what that is? That's God's thumbprint on your leadership right there. And our Heavenly Father is the same. Even if it's hard for you to hear, He asks for your heart. Let's not be so quick to cancel people, amen. Especially Christians. If you're not a follower of Jesus today, you get to cancel all you want. Feel free to do it. But Christians, we love culture of grace, culture of love, and a culture of sanctification. You're not yet where you want to be, but praise God, you're not where you were. Jeremiah, he's called the weeping prophet. What does that mean today? He was a whiner. He was a whiner. Not a lot of ministry success for that guy. It's like 2020 all over again for him every day. It's Groundhog Day. No success. Finish line's always out there, and every time I catch up, they move it again. It's Jeremiah right there, the weeping prophet. So anyway, what happened to him is Zedekiah thought that Jeremiah was a traitor because he was prophesying about Jerusalem's fall. I.e., you keep doing this, you don't listen. As a people, as a nation, you're going to fall. Their leader was like, you can stop saying that. You can knock that off. And he's like, no, I have to be faithful to the Lord. And so Zedekiah threw Jeremiah in prison. Baptist shows up on the scene, and he's a little awkward, just being real. He was like Willie from Duck Dynasty on steroids. Girthy beard, long hair, ate bugs, drank honey. Probably because the bugs gave him heartburn. I'm just guessing. Sorry, you see, Killian, their atmosphere made it come out. Just taking a drink when I said that. So, John the Baptist shows up, a little awkward as he was, but he was a truth teller. Hear the way of the Lord, thus says the Lord. And you know that it's real when it's not about you and what you say, but it's about the one who you're declaring. That's the beauty of all of these prophets of God, is that they weren't saying, I think we should. It was, God says. God says, big difference. So if you, listen, there's always times in sermons where I'll step off the road or I'll say something else that is my assessment of the moment of the text. But my job is to come to you with, this is what God says. That's the package. That's the deal. That's what we're after. Because my words are crummy. My thoughts are crummy. His ways are not my ways. His thoughts are not my thoughts. And his way is the best way, regardless of if you agree with it or not. It's the best. And these prophets said, whether I have to flee, whether you throw me in jail, whether you stick me in a muddy hole, or whether you execute me, or John the Baptist, you chop my head off, I'm faithful and true to the very word. This is what's happening in this parable. You've got to feel the weight of these guys are going to go. Think about this and go, they're hearing these words, and in their mind, they're thinking about these prophets. And the list goes on and on. There's a whole book called Judges about them. Leaders of Israel that came, faithful ones and unfaithful ones, to try to rule well and draw the people back to God. So, the story goes on. None of these worked. There were faithful men and women that did hear those words. Were transformed, but by and large, the tenant farmers did not receive. So the owner says, I got one more. And here's what he says, I have another, a beloved son. And he guesses on who that is. It's Jesus Christ. A beloved son. Finally, he said to them, saying, they will respect my son. Notice how God is relentless in his love and pursuit of you. Even though they've turned me away from hundreds of years, and all these prophets who have gone and preached and preached and preached and preached and called them the truth and called them the truth, and I'm like, now I'm good. Really? Like, you're good? No, your life doesn't show that you're good, man. No, but we're good. We're good. And God just keeps going and going and going and going and chasing. And now, oh, they'll respect my son because he's my son. But those tenants said to one another, this is the heir. Let's get him. Sick him for all he's worth. Come, let us kill him and the inheritance will be ours. And they took him and killed him and threw him out of the vineyard. What will the owner of the vineyard do? Other than that they killed his son, what are they going to do? Now that the tenant farmers are like, now we're out. We don't even like his son. We hate his son. We hated all those other servants, and we really hate his son. What's the owner of the farmer gonna, the vineyard going to do? The text says, he will destroy the tenants. I just don't like that. It's not an interpretation by voting. I'm sorry. We don't get a vote. So if they're not going to receive it, judgment's on them. You see, all that I've done to come and chase after them, and now nothing. No belief, no faith, just fear. So I'll give it to the others. I'll give the kingdom to the others. Jesus is saying, I'll give it to the Gentiles. is always about God getting the gospel to the world. But when the Jews said, I'm out, God said, that's cool. We'll still change the law anyway. And Paul was the one who said, I'm going to take the gospel. I'm going to carry the name of Jesus next time to the temple courts, to the upper leadership, to the kings, to the leaders of the nations of the world. And I will start from the bottom and work my way up. And I will do everything I can to advance the gospel, period. And you're here because of that. You think you're just going to hear because somebody invited you? No, ma'am. No, sir. God wants you to him. He brought you through someone else. And he's been divinely orchestrating that from the beginning of time for you. You don't think God loves you and God cares for you and God sees you in the year that you've walked through this year? He sent you preachers. He has sent you a message like this today. He has sent friends to you. He has sent blog posts to you. He sent crazy weird videos. You have no idea how that showed up on your social media feed. But God, in his sovereign control over all things, said, I got to get her to me. I got to get him to me. And I'm going to leverage all of those things so that they know that I am in radical pursuit of them. And when you see that, you're like, am I seeing this right? Am I seeing this that he is chasing me? Yes, friend. He's chasing you. Believe. Thinking all week about you. And about how God orchestrates all those things for you to hear this. When I was a kid in church, we used to sing this song. God has been a prayer for me, for you, for right now. And we used to sing. As I sat in my office this week, as I drove down the road, I prayed for you and for me that we would see him high and lifted up, that we wouldn't see stone that the builders rejected, that now has become the cornerstone that all things are built upon. That you would see him in his glory high and lifted up, that you wouldn't be like these ridiculous religious leaders that we're all prone to be. Who do you think you are telling me I'm a sinner in need of a savior? Who do you think you are telling me that I need something else? Identity you're longing for, all the hope that you want, all the freedom that you want to experience. Your heart was created to be ruled by the one who is high and lifted up. And he, friends, is building his church, and he is building his kingdom, and he's building it in your heart. Say, look in the eyes of my heart. that as we declare the truth of God's word week in and week out here, you're like, man, that was moving. That was fun. No, we want you to see Jesus. And that's the only answer. That's all I have. And that's all that I need. And when you see him, and you're not in fear, but you believe in faith, Hebrews 11 tells us that we are part of an unshakable kingdom. That unshakable kingdom is not coming into you by the power of the Holy Spirit. It is not with you, and you take that unshakable kingdom into a very shaken world. I guess the question is this: are you seeing? The sinless Son of God, who was born and lived a perfect life, and died to forgive you of your sin, and rose from the dead so that you could be forgiven and free from your sin. It was his life and his blood and his death and his resurrection that allows you to be freed from that sin and freed from the power and the clutches of sin. The Bible tells us that it is by grace through faith that you've been saved. It's not stuff that you do to get you to God, but it's that God got to you. And God stretched you out of death's hands. And the way that you respond to that is by faith. How many of you today would just say, Pastor, I've never responded in faith to Jesus Christ. Not responded with my actions. I've tried to be really good. I've tried to be a normal person. I've tried to show up to church. I've tried to get my kids into church. I've tried to do all the right things. And to be honest with you, I was just kind of hoping that the scales would kind of weigh in my favor. The truth is that there is no one righteous, no, not one, the scripture says. And even one sin would separate you from the love of the Father. But isn't it good that God loved you? That he sent his one and only Son to die for you. For you, even if it was one sin, so that you could live. God purchased your spot in heaven, secured your freedom from sin, and is building a home for you with him forever and ever. And if you've never embraced Christ by faith, this will be a moment for you to say that to me. I need that today. All I want you to do is just by this. It's not even anything magical, but it's just a simple slip your hand up and say, I've never been saved in a day. I want to enter into the family of God. I want to enter into the kingdom. I want to be saved today. Trust you. We can trust your faith.